The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined in this edition by the plant-based powerhouse herself, Ellie Armstrong. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me on. I'm very excited to be here.
Yes. So anyone who's on our Patreon or even checked our Twitter knows that you jumped in at the last minute. So I'm very glad that I'm going to speak to you because I've actually been watching you on WWE Network. So it's nice to speak to someone that I've not discovered, that's not the right word, but someone who I've just newly come into my eyes. I don't know. That's not the words I'm going for. Anyway, first question is always the same. How did you get into wrestling? Yeah. What got you here?
Well, I think mine's is a wee bit different from everyone else's. Like, everyone else seems to go, oh, my dad got me into it, my mum got me into it, my big brothers got me into it. Like, they had nostalgia, they watched it growing up on Sky One. I didn't start watching until 2016. My boyfriend at the time had no one to go to the Raw and SmackDown tapings at the Hydro with, so he was like, you're coming with me. And I was like, all right, if you buy the tickets, I'll go. Sound. And yeah, he was like, oh, you should probably watch a couple episodes of Raw and SmackDown so you get what's going on. And I was like, ugh, fine, whatever. Let's put them on. They're on Sky Sports. So I was still in uni, so I was like, right, Sky Sports, 1 a.m. Monday morning, I will watch Raw. So it was not the Raw after SummerSlam, but the Raw after SummerSlam, if that makes sense, or two Raws after SummerSlam. Kevin Owens is Universal Champion, and it was Kevin Owens and Chris Jericho and Chris, their whole best pals gimmick and Chris Jericho's list, and I just thought it was the funniest thing I've ever seen, and that's what got me hooked, pretty much. Like, from there on, I was like, yes, I like this. It's like Coronation Street, but with men punching each other. I'm down, because I didn't even really know it was a thing growing up. Like, I'm late to the party completely.
I was just trying to think, what were the highlights of 2016? Because now I'm old and I've watched for so long now. But yeah, Chris Jericho in the list. That's a pretty good way to get into it. So were they your two ones you like straight away? Kevin Owens, Chris Jericho, or is there any others that kind of caught your eye?
Yeah, so I mean, I think if it wasn't for Kevin Owens and Chris Jericho, we wouldn't be sitting here, me and you, today. Like, they sucked me in from the very beginning. But at the same time, like, I kind of knew what wrestling was. Like, obviously I knew what it was, but like, I never really watched it. But I always had this view, obviously antiquated now, of like, oh, they don't treat women well. Like, women are the side pieces, the brand panties matches, that sort of thing, which for like me, I was a mad feminist, and I still am, but like proper, like, when I was in my teenage years, so that would have put me off wrestling if I'd tried to watch it then. But my boyfriend at the time, he showed me Sasha Bailey at Brooklyn, the Iron Woman match, the 30-minute one, and I was like, wow, this is amazing. Like, maybe they don't treat women as bad as I thought they did. I suppose the revolution had kind of started at that point, but at that, I watched that match and I was like, what? So Bailey had me hooked straight away. I just thought she was amazing. I still do. Even though she's turned heel, I'm like, I love you. You're my favourite forever. Sami Zayn as well. I think I've just got a thing for underdogs, really. But Sami Zayn, even his gimmick now, I think it's incredible. Like, getting like Logan Paul on and everything, it's just mad. I love it.
So from what I'm getting, from the ones that you've named so far, it's, I mean, they're all fantastic wrestlers. That's without saying. But it seems to be this literally the big characters, the soap part of it, which, you know, that's probably the best way to put it, because wrestling is panto. That's what it is. It really is. I think recently this big APPG, whatever it is, pretty much said training is sport, the shows are theatre. And it's like,
yeah, I read that today, yeah.
So yeah, that's pretty much.
I have to.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. On you go.
Sorry, I don't want to interrupt you. On you go. I was gonna say, like, I find the characters so much more interesting. Like, someone could do all the moves in the world, and I'm not gonna name any wrestlers here. Like, but like, you could do all the moves in the world, but if you've got the personality of a plank, I'm not going to want to watch your matches, no matter how athletically amazing they are. I'm just going to be like, why would I root for you? Because you can do a flip. Cool. But if you've got like a personality and you can safely wrestle and you can have a fun match, I'm way more likely to be interested than just someone doing a flip. If you know what I mean, yeah.
Absolutely. Wrestling is, for me anyway, it's your moments. So you watch it for, I mean, like, I enjoy NXT, and I do enjoy it, but sometimes I'm just like, these are just wrestling for the sake of wrestling. Give me someone like Dexter Lumis out, who's a bit mental. Give me that for a bit, and I'll enjoy it. So yeah, there's definitely a place for really great wrestling. People will enjoy it, but I think I'm on the same wavelength as you. I want to enjoy characters, I want to enjoy the fun. That's why I like going to independent shows as well, because there's usually more characters than not.
Exactly. Just the banter you have with a crowd. Like, I actually love kids, like more family friendly, like independent shows, like the kids shows, where it's like an absolute panto and the kids are going wild. Like, one of the favorite best things I've ever seen was at the, I think it was SWA Motherwell Rumble back in like 2017 or 2018, and it was just the way the kids were reacting to Sha Samuels, and he was just hamming it up, being like the big bad, and I was like, this is incredible. Like, they are booing him so much, but it's so cute because like, they're so into it. I just love, I think kids, when they're into wrestling that much and they proper get into the characters, I think that's the best thing in the world. Like, I think it was Sha Samuels versus, like, I can't even remember who was wrestling, because they were reacting to Sha Samuels so much, and he was just hamming it up, and I was like, this is wrestling for me. Like, that's what it is. The big characters.
And sometimes there's not even a rhyme or reason why kids will flock to one person and go, oh, we're going to boo you the whole time, and you don't know why, but you're going to take it for 20 minutes. It's just,
yeah,
it's the best. So from, like, you're just new to wrestling, going to the Raw and SmackDown, 2016, was that possibly the debut of Noam Dar? I think, I don't know, just guessing.
Yeah, that was the night that Noam Dar debuted I think it was like on the main event and taping before Raw, but that was the night Noam Dar made his WWE debut, I think, yeah. And the place was mad. And I was like, I don't know who this guy is. Why is everyone going mental? Like, I know he's obviously, but I was just like, I don't know who this is.
So after that, you caught the bug. Did your ex drag you to local shows? I mean, you said SWA in 2017. So did you go to quite a few local shows in Glasgow, in the area?
Yeah. Actually, before we even made it to the Raw and SmackDown tapings, we went to an ICW show in the garage, and I think it was back when Trent Seven was still champion, ICW World Champion, and that was technically the first wrestling show I went to. I can't remember who else was on the show except from Trent, but that was the first wrestling show I went to. It was at one of the ICWs in the garage, and it was amazing. Like, that made me want to go to Raw and SmackDown even more, because I was like, oh, this is what it's like to actually see in person. It's great.
Did you find when you went to Raw and SmackDown after that, though, you think, oh, this is a bit tame? Everyone's kind of just enjoying themselves, whereas you went to ICW and it's just a bit... I mean, I've only ever went to the Aberdeen ones, so they're not as rowdy, but it seems like a bit of a wild atmosphere in the garage.
Yeah, like, the garage shows are mad, and that, especially that for the first one, because... as I was saying, like, when I went to the Raw and SmackDown tapings, at least I knew who most of the folk were. Like I said, I didn't know who Noam Dar was, but it was his debut. Well, forgive me for that. But, like, the ICW tapings, I didn't know who most folk were. Like, I knew Wolfgang, and I knew who Viper was, because we kind of looked it up before we went. and I knew who Trent Seven was. But apart from that, I was like, I don't really know who these people were. So it was quite fun to find out, like, oh, they're booing him. But why are they booing him? Mm. And you got into it quite quickly. And the crowd in the garage are absolutely mental. Like, they always are.
So how did you go from watching it? I mean, that's a quick turnaround, going from watching it to now doing it. So why did you start at GPWA?
So, again, I think it's weirdly different to everyone else's answers, but I watched on Netflix, and in, like, the second or third episode, they have, like, them starting to train for Glow for the first time, and it's just them rolling about and doing, like, simple lockups and simple bumps, and I'm going, do you know, that looks really fun. I'd actually quite like to try that. And at the time, I was like, there's ICW shows in Glasgow, so they must train in Scotland somewhere. So I literally just Googled Pro Wrestling School Glasgow. GPWA was the first one to come up on Google. I don't know if it was just because it's Glasgow Pro Wrestling Academy or because it was the closest one to me. Clicked on it. There was an induction class that October. I think this was like the July, and there was an induction class in the October, and I was like, do you know what? I'm in my final year of uni. We may as well go for it. Like, if not now, when? So I was like, right. Paid the induction fee, and the rest, as they say, is history, as the saying goes.
So have you got an athletic background beforehand, like any sports before you started training?
In primary school, yes. I think I was really, not athletic, but I was really sporty in primary school. Like, I was a proper wee tomboy, like, loved the football, played netball. I was on my primary school's netball team. We won the championship, Linlithgow Primary School Netball Championship 2007 or whatever it was. That's my brag. So we won that league on the boys' team because I went to a tiny primary school, so they didn't have enough girls to make a girls' team. So I was on the boys' team. So I loved football on those. I went to high school and I just hit my emo phase, and I was like, I don't want to do this anymore. I just want to sit in the house and read books. Kind of stopped after at high school. I didn't really do any sports in high school. And then a couple of times, and then was like, do you know what? I'm going to run the Glasgow 10K, like the big run they do at like September every year. I've done that, and that's when I started getting a wee bit sporty again. But that was like 2016, so it was quite late on between primary school and starting running. So the first training session at GPWA was not a fun time for me. Oh, my cardio was not good. Couldn't do a push-up, couldn't do a forward roll, and it was not a fun time. I was like, do I have what this takes? Because this is hard. I didn't expect it to be this hard. Like, Glow did not make it look this hard, and it was. And I was just like, oh. The only thing I could do was a cartwheel, which is why that's now my signature move, because we've got to keep the consistency. Literally the only thing I could do on my first day of GPWA was a star jump and a cartwheel. So we've kept it there.
I can just imagine you coming home after the first session and just like cursing Alison Brie and everyone going, you made it look easy. So that first session, I've heard the forward roll is the make or break for most wrestling trainees. It seems to be, if you can't do one, you're going to have a tough time. That's pretty much the thing.
Yeah, and I couldn't do one till into my induction course, like very close to the end. I was still not able to get to my feet. Like, I could do the roll. Can do it now. We've grown, we've progressed. Can now do a forward roll, can confirm.
So, I mean, you went to see ICW, of course. So coming into that induction, you likely would have had guys like Wolfgang, Jester, BT Gunn, Lionheart. Was it the actual full lineup of coaches, or was there just the one or two you started with?
Yeah, for our first day, we had all five of them. We had Riddle, Harto, Wolfgang, BT, and Jester, all five of them, and it was quite intimidating walking in for the first time. I didn't go with anyone, so I was walking in on my own, didn't know anyone, and it was just like, oh, I'll see all these guys. So this is quite intimidating, like, oh, quite scared now, but it was fine. They're all lovely, so, and straight away, because it was straight into cardio and push-ups and star jumps and everything, but they made you feel comfortable, so I wasn't ever like I was going to get like called out because I couldn't do a sit up or a push up on the first day. It was the eased you in.
So how did you go from, so you did your induction, of course, went into the next phase. I think they do a couple phases if I'm right in my reading. Was there a point where you were going to be on shows before all this lockdown happened, or what stage were you at before lockdown?
My aim for, like, I wrote my, like, I don't like to call it New Year's resolutions because I think that's setting yourself up for failure, but it was kind of like a goals I'd like to hit this year at the start of 2020. So it was like deadlift 120 kilos, squat my body weight, like stupid stuff like this. And then it was like get debut on a show, and I just wanted it to be like a 5-pound wrestling GPWA show. I wasn't aiming for the big leagues at all. And then lockdown hit, and like I know from like coaches, like Stevie was saying, like, oh, you know, you're pretty close to being on a show, like it'll probably happen end of 2020. I was getting told this at the start of 2020, like, keep doing what you're doing, by the end of 2020 we'll get you on a 5-pound show. And I was like, cool, that's great, that's something to aim towards, and like just that sort of thing. And then lockdown hit and I was like, no, it's never gonna happen. And it was a kind of harrowing, like, oh no, I'm not gonna hit any of my goals for this year because the gyms are shut, wrestling's not happening. I hit one of the goals, I got the debut, didn't get the squat or the deadlift because the gyms were shut.
It must have been weird though, because your debut of course was on, I mean, just a little thing called the WWE Network. But of course, it was pre-taped in front of nobody. I don't think I'm killing the blowing anyone's mind to reveal that. But What was it like going into your first match, knowing that for in your mind there's nobody there, but there's going to be a potential couple million watching?
It was weird. Weird is the only way I can describe it, because we obviously have training matches in training because GPWA's got some rings. So we'll always, not at the end of every training session, but at least once a week, you'll get to do a training match in front of everyone else at training. But we've always been taught, like, play to the crowd, like do your moves towards the crowd, know where your crowd's going to be. When you do your entrance, you're going to G up the crowd. When you hit move, you're gonna get your energy from the crowd, if that sort of thing. And then to have my debut match with three cameras and nobody to G up, nobody to give me that like feedback, like they're enjoying it, was weird. Like you're just wrestling in dead silence, which I've never done before, because in training matches we're always G'ing each other on, even if, you know, you're not doing your best, you've always got someone G'ing you on. And then I'm wrestling to like three cameras. We've got the two movable ones and the hard cam. And we'd never really practiced selling to camera. So I'm like, oh, I think I know what to do, but do I actually know what I'm doing? So I'm turning up the day ICW late. Right, I know my match, I know I'm wrestling, but where are the cameras gonna be? Like, and it was like I had to learn that on the day. It was a steep learning curve, I'd say. But it was weird. Weird's the only way I can describe it.
So what were your thoughts when you got the call, though? The call going, right, we're taping a couple of shows at the Asylum, we want you on. What was, like, your thoughts into that?
So the way it happened, so GPWA, back when we were, like, Glasgow was in, I think it was, like, tier 2 or tier 3 back in September, GPWA opened for like wee 1-to-1 sessions. So you, it would just be you and a coach, and it would basically just be cardio drills and getting you used to bumping in the ring again. So I had one of them with Jester, and he was just like, do you have any promo photos? And I was like, no, but I mean, I've got like the ring light at home. I could take some like really amateur ones in my spare room. And he was like, yeah, do that, because ICW are needing women. And I was like, this is not where I thought this conversation was going. So I sent him them, not expecting anything. Like, I was just like, oh, maybe they just want to see what's out there, because like there's loads of talented women in Scottish wrestling. So I was like, they're never even going to consider me, but like it's nice that Jester's thrown my hat in the ring, like he's been nice, like he's my coach, so I appreciate that. And then literally, like, so I came home, this was like the Monday, I took the photos the Tuesday afternoon, sent them over, I was like, there you go, here's like a full body one, like a kind of half body one and a head one, whatever. And then like literally on like the Thursday, he was like, yeah, are you free? You can come to the ICW tape. And I was like, this is not what I expected, but yes, I am free on Sunday. I will make time. What time do you want me? When do you want me there? And yeah, it was weird. It was exciting. I didn't expect it at all. Like, as I said, Jester just asked for promo photos and I was just like, maybe it'll happen, maybe it won't. And then literally for it to happen that week was mad. Absolutely mad.
Yeah, because you weren't the only one. When I was watching it, it was Moxie Malone, I think, popped up as well as a new face. I think she did a couple of 5 pound wrestling shows, but it was weird seeing all these new faces, considering that there's been no shows on. So I'm thinking, how's that happened? But you've wrestled pretty much just about everyone that's also there. So I think was your first match, was it? And I've written that down in the list of names, didn't write them in any order, because why would I? Was it Molly Spartan you debuted against?
Molly Spartan was my first match, yeah. And I was so thankful that it was Molly, because she trained at GPWA as well. So while all the lassies on the ICW roster are like super talented and they're all amazing, Molly was the only one I'd wrestled in a training match before, so we already knew each other a wee bit. Like, we'd only wrestled a couple of times in training, but at least we'd wrestled before, so it kind of put my mind at ease. I was like, right, I know our moves, I know how to take them, I can breathe a wee bit more, and like I'm not having to like introduce myself to someone, be like, right, we need to get to know each other quickly now, plan a match. No, it was really good to have Molly, just someone I knew. It did put me at ease a wee bit.
And it wasn't long, was it, maybe your second or third match? Yeah, you were against Emily Hayden that you actually picked up your first win as well. So again, you're on WWE Network and you're winning, you've won a match. Have you watched back any of your matches on the WWE Network itself?
Yeah, like I've watched them all a couple of times now. That makes me sound pure vain, but it's mostly because I keep having to like, I want to watch them for myself, like, because you don't get better if you don't watch your own matches, and you need to be able to pick up on like, oh, if I was going to do something different, like, oh, I could do that better, I could do this better, you know, standard stuff like that. But also like my mum is pure fear. She's like, I know you're fine, but like it scares me to watch it, so I have to sit down and watch it with her so she knows I'm fine. Like, I'm sitting there next to her, she's got it on her iPad, and I'm like, look mum, I'm fine, I'll tell you when to close your eyes if there's something really scary coming up and you don't have to watch that. So I have watched them a couple of times because I need to watch them with my mum.
So you're not the kind of, so I mean, you say invade, but you're not the kind of, if someone comes into the house, someone new, you're just like going, that's me there on the telly.
Oh no. Like I made my friends watch my first one. Like I did that with the first one with Molly, but that was like the excitement of it. I was like, right, when are we meeting up? Like, I don't even care, we can do it over Zoom if you want, we can do it over FaceTime, whatever. We're all getting this. Here's my network login. Yous can be fine. You're just watching. I don't care if you don't watch any other ones, because half my pals aren't even into wrestling. They're all like girly girls. But I was like, you need to at least watch the first one. Like, please.
And then you said it's been weird, but how weird is it considering you're on Peacock in the US, which has got a couple million, I think it's got, I can't remember the number, I should have written it down because I've said this so many times now, I think it's a couple, 30 million homes or something like that. So there's a potential 30 million people watching you.
Oh, I don't even like to think about that. Like, oh, too many people to even fathom. Like, that's, it's mad. So I'm just like, no, no. But I did get a wee bit excited when I realised you could search my name on the WWE Network and my matches would come up. I was like, oh, that's exciting.
I know, like,
that's the most excited I've been was my name.
And then you've got the folk that seem to be the gift machines that make gifts of these shows, and you're like, well, God, that's me. I'm a gift now.
Yeah. I was tempted to do that myself back in, like, my Tumblr days. I used to sit and make gifts of, like, Doctor Who and Marilyn, and I was like, how do people make gifts these days? Because I used to have to, like, download torrent these episodes of Doctor Who, put them through VLC player, screenshot them a million times, and then manually make a GIF in Photoshop. And I was like, how do people make GIFs these days? Like, that's how we did it in 2011, but I don't know how they make them these days. There's probably an app for it or something.
Possibly. Something like that. I've never learned. I was into the torrent days. I killed many a computer with LimeWire. But yeah, GIFs, I'm just like, I'll let other people do it. It's fine. They know what they're doing. It just seems like a just something I get annoyed at really quickly trying to make. And considering the way you did it, I don't think I'd even bother. I'd do one screenshot and going, it's not worth doing this. It's just, nah, someone could do it. It's fine.
I think back of how many hours I poured into making Doctor Who GIFs when I was like 13 and 14. Like, I must have been hundreds of hours that I would sit in Photoshop, because Tumblr had like an upload limit at that point, so GIFs couldn't be more than a megabyte, so you had to like compress them right down. It was an art form just to get them uploaded, never mind how good they looked like.
So I think I'll be remiss, because a lot of people that listen or at least speak to me are Doctor Who fans. I got into it Tennant and then kind of dropped off a little bit after that. So which is your favorite Doctor?
Matt Smith, 100%. You dropped out at the wrong time. I love Matt Smith so much.
See, I tried.
Absolute
fave. I watched
David
some
Tennant,
of them.
Even like top three for me.
But no, I tried to watch.
Popular opinion, but
yeah. Yeah, I tried to watch Matt Smith. I didn't mind it. I just find myself like just doing other things on a Saturday instead. I think it was when I still lived like 50 miles from anywhere, so I had to drive. So if I was going to see my mates, I was there overnight, and they weren't a Doctor Who fan, so I just wasn't watching it on a Saturday. I'd come home on a Sunday and just sleep and then go back to work and another. Yeah, so it just wasn't. I might go back eventually, but by this point there's that many to watch. I end up getting lost, but we're still in lockdown, so who knows. I might get into a Doctor Who phase by now.
Even if you just watch Matt Smith's first season, like season 5, I think that's like peak Doctor Who, in my opinion. So just that season, it's only like 13 episodes, you're fine.
I'll bear that in mind. So you're the plant-based powerhouse, is the moniker, yeah, you're going with. So, I mean, from that, I can safely assume you're vegetarian or vegan.
Vegan.
And you're not a typical vegan, because we're 25 minutes into an episode and you haven't told me. So that's the meme. So what made you decide to go on to be a vegan?
So I did start off vegetarian, and honestly, it was just to stop myself eating McDonald's when I was at work. Basically, like, there was a McDonald's right across the road from my work, and I was genuinely having like a Big Mac meal or like a double cheeseburger meal every day for my lunch. So I was like, right, if I just cut out meat, I can't have a McDonald's, because I don't like the McDonald's vegetarian options. So that's what I did, and then that was 5 years ago. And then about a year into being vegetarian, maybe 8 months, I watched Carnage on BBC Three, which was like a mockumentary thing by Simon Amstel, which was like set in, I think it was like 2051, where the whole of the UK is vegan and like eating meat's a thing of a past. No one does it. And it was like funny, but it was also kind of eye-opening. And I was like, and there was a one really sad bit about like how they take baby cows away from their mums so that like humans can drink the milk. And it made me really, really upset. And I haven't touched any animal products since I seen that. Not purposefully anyway, I think I've accidentally eaten like cheese once, but since I seen that and the image is like bored into my mind, I'm like, no, the poor baby cows, I can't do it anymore.
So yeah, I'm always, I am nowhere near that at all, but I always think that I probably could do it, but I like chicken too much. So I could probably cut out every other kind of meat, but chicken would have to stay. So it's always considered, and then eventually I've had chicken that much, I go, I nearly need a chili or something like that. I need a mince. But I tried corn, and oh my God, that is the most disgusting thing on the planet. What's your?
I don't like corn.
So what would be your?
I don't like corn in general.
Oh, it's well, my wife's doesn't like chili beef. You get it at shops and Asda and that to put on top of your pizzas because yeah. She likes to chew her beef herself, which is fair. But I find this wasn't even that. It was just grit. I tried corn once. Hated it.
No, I don't really like any of the corn products, but a lot of the corn products aren't vegan anyway. A lot of them have egg whites in them, so I don't even have to think about it. I can just avoid them now, so easy peasy. Speaking of chicken, though, like the chicken substitutes have gotten like scarily good in the last couple of years. Like sometimes I'll buy vegan chicken and I'll be like, are you sure? Like that tastes exactly and the exact same texture of what I remember chicken looking and tasting like. So not that I'm trying to convert you, but
no, if it tastes exactly the same and it's better for me, I'm all in. But yeah, corn stung me because I pestered my wife for weeks thinking, oh, we'll try a vegan week, we'll try a vegetarian week, we'll go off the meat because it's lockdown, we've eaten so much of it. And yeah, that just stung us. And we end up putting half of it in the freezer and then eventually got to the point where we looked at it and went, that's not getting eaten. That's just going to go. That's just in the bin. Bye-bye. That's it. So as a wrestler, though, I know there's a lot of wrestlers that are vegan. Of course, Daniel Bryan being the most famous, I would think. You've still got to take in a lot of like proteins and energies and... Is that the word? Mm-hmm. Kilojoules.
Yeah.
Work off in wrestling. So what would be your kind of typical diet, I suppose?
Oh, mine's is so boring. Like, so I'll have, on like a good day where I'm not eating like absolute rubbish, which has been most of lockdown, but on a good day, it's like, I'll have like porridge with like almond butter and bananas for breakfast. And I make all my cereals with soy milk. I don't get this oat milk hype at all. Soy milk will always be the best plant milk forever and always, and I will stand by that. People can come at me, but soy milk is the best plant milk, and I will fight anyone on that. Oat milk can no. Anyway, so porridge with soy milk, almond butter, bananas, and then it's chicken and rice for lunch, protein shake. And then usually some form of, I just eat a lot of fake meat, so it'll either be like fake meat, like usually seitan, which is like wheat gluten and it has like a kind of chickeny texture, seitan and potatoes, or I'll have lentil pasta, which is like super high in protein with like fake meatballs, stuff like that. Just a lot of fake meat, some protein powder, almond butter. It's great.
It's like you're mentally going, I'm still eating meat, but and like you're trying to convince yourself you're still eating meat, but not eating meat at the same time.
Because like I never dislike the texture of meat. Like I know you get some vegans who genuinely like either they don't like the texture of meat, or the texture of meat reminds them of like dead animals, so it upsets them and they don't eat it. Whereas I genuinely like meat, like I liked it, but my like heart wouldn't let me eat it at all. Like it would just upset me. So I'm gonna have any and all substitutes that will come my way. Like I know processed food isn't good for you. Blah blah blah. Blah. I don't care. Like, if it tastes good and it's not completely killing me, then I'm fine.
Fine. That's a good way to go about it. Right. So we did get a question in from Emily Hayden, who of course has been pretending. That's not wrestling. Has been trying to break your arm on the WWE Network. She has asked. Just to ask you about your Persona 5 addiction.
Oh, so I wouldn't consider myself like a gamer. Like I've never been like super into games. Like the way it goes is like I'll play a game, I'll be absolutely obsessed with it, and then I'll go like months and months without playing a game. So, and I normally just tend to play like Nintendo games. Like I've always had a DS, I got a Switch, like so it's usually like Pokemon, Zelda. Those kind of games I'll play. Like I was bored one day and like I came across a PS4 on Gumtree. This was only like a couple of weeks ago. This was like a month ago. On Gumtree for like £180. And I was like, you know what? I'm just going to buy it. It's £180 as a PS4, whatever. So I bought that. And then my pal was like, you like Pokemon? There's this game on the PS store that's down to like £11. And it's a wee bit like Pokemon, but it's like a high school drama. And I think you'd really enjoy it. And I was like, £11? I mean, I need something to play on this PlayStation that I've just bought because I don't have any games, so sure, I'll bought it. Genuinely, I only bought it 3 weeks ago, I think, and I have sunk like 80 hours into this game. I am absolutely obsessed with it and I cannot stop playing. Like, I was playing it before you called me, I'm going to be playing it after you call me. It's amazing. It's very good.
I need to keep an eye out for it because as soon as I got a I mean, I've always been a PlayStation player anyway, PS1 to now. But I got a Vita, not last year, year before, because that's when we could do things, go outside. And as soon as I put it up saying I need some game recommendations, Persona came up constantly, Persona 4, Golden, whatever. And I was like, okay, yeah, I'll check it out. And I looked at the price, and I was like, oh, no. Not for something I'm not sure about, but if it pops in under a tenner, I might give it a crack. If it's much like Pokemon esque, then it has to be.
It's like turn based kind of combat, which suits me because I've tried playing games like COD and Battlefield and like GTA, like where everything's happening at once, and I just get so overwhelmed and I just panic and I just button mash. Like I cannot play Super Smash Bros or any game like that because I'm just a button masher. I will just be sitting there like fluke winning because I'm just hitting the right keys at the right time, but there's no skill involved there whatsoever. So he was like, this is turn-based combat, this will suit you. And I was like, yes, I've got time to think about things, it's great. And it's like a lot of the imagery in it is like tarot cards, and it's based so you collect tarot cards through it, and I love tarot cards. Like I don't even believe in like psychic stuff like that, but I'm just obsessed with tarot cards. I think the aesthetic of them is like really cool, and a lot of like the personas which you capture, which is like their version of Pokemon, are all based on like different legends from around the world. So you've got some from Irish mythology, some from Norse mythology, Chinese mythology, Japanese mythology and stuff like that. And it's just, I love that sort of thing. I love mythology. Just a good time.
Yeah, I'm pretty much the same for games. I like to have a thought. I like just games I can wander around and collect stuff. Spyro being a perfect example. But one I'd probably recommend if you're...
I played the Spyro last year. That was what I played on my Switch like all of last year. I had a great time. It was the first time of me playing it. I never played it when I was wee, so I bought the remastered trilogy for the Switch and I had a great time.
Nice.
Not very good at it, but I had a great time.
Oh, I mean, the flying ones, the like Dreamscape ones, they could just disappear entirely because I hate them. But the rest of them, I love. But yeah, that, and for a game I'd recommend then, just because I think it was free a couple of weeks ago, was the Ratchet and Clank. it's kind of the same kind of play as Spyro, I would think. You're just running around collecting stuff, killing enemies. So yeah, definitely, I'm the same. I'll get a game, and if I really enjoy it, I'll just sink hours into it. I've finished Ratchet and Clank, saw I had some trophies left, and I thought, oh, well, I've still got time in the evening. I'll just restart it. Started it again, played it through. Like, I played it four times over a space of 2 weeks, because I was just enjoying it far too much. So back to the wrestling, quite briefly. So during lockdown, of course, you briefly got to do some training. You briefly got to do some wrestling. What else have you been up to? Are you working? Have you been studying? What's been your last year of your life?
So I work in a hospital, so I've had a great time. I haven't stopped. luckily not on wards or anything. I'm a technician by day, so I'm very much backroom staff, but like, we had to like take care of all the ventilators and stuff that were keeping folk alive, so that was a stressful time. A lot of overtime for me last April when it was at its peak. It was a good time.
Wow, okay, so I see why you got back in. You're getting to the game a bit more. It seems to be a good distraction. Same with actually getting to punch people for a couple of weekends, which is probably a good stress reliever. And have you been keeping up with wrestling as well? Just as watching it, any independent shows on, obviously online because you can't go to them, anything like that, or is it just WWE?
I've only really been watching like the big pay-per-views. So like, I think Rumble was honestly the last wrestling I've watched outside of ICW. Like, I've watched all the fight clubs that have gone up since they started going up on the network, and like Bard and everything like that. But in terms of other wrestling, I just feel like I don't have the time for it anymore. And then the Rumble is my favorite pay-per-view ever since I started watching wrestling. I was like, yeah, this is my kind of thing. I love the counting. It's just a great time. So I made sure I got the day off work after Rumble so I could watch the Rumble, because who doesn't love the Rumble? And then I've got the day off work on Monday so I can watch WrestleMania properly and not be tired. So I'm excited for that.
The Rumble is the absolute best. Because it's been so weird with the sounds and that, with no crowds either, that's what I'm... It's my wife's favourite. She loves the Rumble. She's never seen a WWE Raw Rumble, but she goes to Regal Rumble when it comes to WrestleZone in Aberdeen. Awesome. So we've made up a promise. If crowds are back next year, she's going to stay up, like one of us, at 1 o'clock in the morning to watch the Royal Rumble. And I am absolutely buzzing. As far as taking the day off...
I love any type of Rumble. Yeah.
I don't know what it is.
Any Rumble... Rumble, ICW Square Go. I've not been to the Regal Rumble, but I went to the Disco one, the Discovery Wrestling one. That was a great time. Any type of Rumble, it's just, you can't beat them. Best type of match, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think you sit there and go, right, what are the rules? Well, you throw out the other ones till there's one left. Fine, easy, I've got this. That's it. There's literally, you don't need to explain anything else. As long as they go out, 2 feet hit the ground.
No.
Done. And it's just, yeah, fantastic. But WrestleMania, every year I say I'm not going to stay up and watch it, and every year I wake up on Monday with only 2 hours of sleep thinking I hate my decisions in life. Thankfully, this year, though, this is my office because I work from home because of COVID. So, you know, I can look like absolute... I'm trying not to swear in these podcasts.
You can just crawl up.
Pretty much. My bed's the other side of this wall. That's it. It's great. So I'll be watching as of recording, I'll be watching TakeOver tonight, WrestleMania Saturday, WrestleMania Sunday. I'm going to try and watch Raw on Thunderdome. And Tuesday, nice. I'm still going to be sitting here. So God help anyone who phones in on Tuesday for an insurance-based query for my job, because obviously they're going... Didn't speak to me. Just leave me alone. I stayed up for 3 hours of Raw and nothing happened.
That's so, my plan for Saturday, to catch up on all the takeovers and all the Raws and everything on Saturday before Mania starts, because I'm not staying up during the week when I have to actually leave the house.
So we'll do a couple of our silly questions, and we'll kind of do a bit more wrestling stuff, I suppose, because, you know, wrestling podcast. What's your favourite dinosaur?
Oh, my wee brother's going to kill me because he's obsessed with dinosaurs, and I'll say the wrong name, but I'd probably say a stegosaurus, and he's going to be like, that's not actually called a stegosaurus. Anyway, I'd say a stegosaurus. Big spikes.
Great. I knew you'd go for a herbivore. I just absolutely knew it. Right. what would win in a fight? I mean, this is probably going to be a very distasteful question for you. What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow, definitely. Cows are protective animals. Yeah. They're big dogs. They've got teeth.
I get different answers. Well, it was only two answers, but I get different answers for that one. But I like anyone who comes with a bit of logic with it as well. Like, yeah, it's like, it's bigger. It's going to do it. I don't like anyone who just goes, one cow, and then kills it, stone dead. No, tell me why you decide that one. I still think two sheep, but, you know, we'll never find out unless it's somehow coerced in some sort of weird gala show. When you got the wrestling ring in one corner, and then
the sheep fighting in the other side.
So outside of wrestling, you've already revealed you're a big Doctor Who fan, and Merlin fan, which I did actually watch one series of that as well when it came on the BBC. I seem to half watch these things, unfortunately. Although I watched Life on Mars, I'm just about to finish that again, which is totally.
I love Life on Mars. I just rewatched all of Life on Mars and Ashes to Ashes like a couple of months ago. Obsessed. I forgot how good they were. They're so good.
Oh, I mean, I saw it was coming off Netflix like April 6th. And I thought, and this was April 1st. Oh, I'll get through all the episodes by then. No, I'm four out, but iPlayer's got it, thankfully. I'll finish watching it. But yeah, I forgot how fun it was. So we're now in the lockdown phase of just revisiting things that I used to watch, because I don't want to watch anything new, because it's an effort. If it's not Falcon and the Winter Soldier, then leave me alone. I'll watch something I've watched before. What are you other
watching? Modern Family.
Yes, love it.
Love Modern Family.
My TikTok for you page is primarily seems to be Modern Family and Brooklyn Nine-Nine stuff at the moment.
Brooklyn Nine-Nine is probably my favourite TV show, like, of all time, I'd say. I love it so much. Like, I think I've seen every episode at least 5 times, and I'm including the ones that only came out last year. Like, genuinely love it so much.
Oh, we went to Netflix when the new season came out, and we thought, oh, we'll spread it over the week. Came out on the Friday, finished it by the Sunday. And we were just like, ah.
Yeah.
Okay, right. What have we got now then? that's it. So yeah, outside of wrestling, what's your passions? What do you end up, what's your hobbies?
I'd say, well, recently, COVID kind of ruined them all, but big football fan. I'll say I'm a Celtic fan, we'll divide it. But yeah, big Celtic fan. Season ticket holder, even this year when we haven't been able to go to games, so I've paid £600 for a dodgy link, pretty much, but wait, is what you do. There was a joke between me and my mum that, because she doesn't like me getting hurt, so she was like, Ellie, I wish you'd never taken up wrestling, I wish you'd taken up embroidery instead. So when training got cancelled last year, I took up embroidery and got really into it and got quite good at it as well, and I was like, there you go, mum. I've done both, so sharp.
I had a fear that you were going to say that your mum wanted me to take up embroidery because it's safer and you stabbed your fingers and stuff. I was just going to be the total other end of that
story. I stabbed myself a lot, to be fair, but not as bad as the bruises I get from wrestling. I bruise like an absolute peach, so I'd come home absolutely black and blue from training, and not even from folk, just from the ropes. Like, one wee hit off the ropes and I am bruised, like, completely.
That's why I always hear the bumping. It you get used to it, but the ropes is just something. It takes a long time to just get calloused and hit it without wincing. Yeah. So your wrestling style, of course, there's no structure to this podcast. We jump all over the place. Your wrestling style, you do a lot of punching. Of course, you've got your cartwheel, the cartwheel splash. Yeah. Is there any particular wrestlers that you mold your moveset off of? Anything that you watch particularly, go, oh, I'll take that from so-and-so and what have you?
I feel like I did steal quite a lot of my moveset off Bailey, especially with like the belly-to-belly suplex that I do. I was like, oh, pretty much when I was training, I was pretty much doing her whole belly-to-belly sequence. And then I think it was like Wolfgang was like, you need to start coming into your own now, like stop using Bailey's comeback. I was like, right, okay, I'll think of my own moves, god damn it. And then my cartwheel, like I said, I got it because it was the only thing I could do, but it was also like kind of like Maiko Satomura. She was the big influence of doing a cartwheel because I was like trying to think of a way to put a cartwheel into a move that isn't just a cartwheel dropkick, because a lot of the lassies on the Scottish scene already did that. Like Moxie does one, Anastasia does one. So I was like, right, I can't do a cartwheel dropkick because then I'm just stealing moves again. And I think it was Michael versus Kaylee Ray at Pro Eve, and Michael does the cartwheel, leg drop, and I was like, that looks sick, like that looks absolutely deadly, but I don't want to steal it completely. So I was like, right, how can I put my own spin on this? And I was like, we'll try splash, that's easy. And then I did it in one training match and everyone was like, that looks really cool, you need to keep that. And I was like, okay, I will. So I'd say Bailey, Michael Satomura. I love the kind of like hard-hitting, like Joshi, like Japanese women proper. They just look like they're leathering each other, and I think it's a wee bit better when it just genuinely looks like a fight. Like, and I'd say like Viper as well, like being a bigger lassie, it's good to have these bigger lassies to look up to see what you do. Like, I'm not flexible, so I'm not going to be pulling people into like amazing holds or anything. So I want to see like the big power moves that lassies are doing.
What we'll say about your splash, like one thing I noticed, because like I say, you only have what, four or five matches that have been aired. Don't know if you've had more since. Mm-hmm. It's really nice to see a splash done where you don't land on your knees. Like you do the whole body weight, so it actually looks like it hurts. Mm-hmm. Whether your opponent thinks it does or doesn't is another matter entirely. But it looks like it's actually a splash and not just a cartwheel into landing on my knees and just like crouching over. I super enjoy that. I kind of guess you're a Celtic fan, not just because I do some research this afternoon, but of course your gear being very green and white in its colour scheme. Was that a conscious decision when you got your gear made?
Yeah, like I didn't want it to be like green, like Celtic green, because I also feel like, you know, like Joe Coffey gets like Celtic kits made into gear. I was like, right, I can't even nick his ideas. So I'll go for like a more, it's still green, but it's not Celtic green. It's not obvious that it's green and white, but like if you know me, you know it's green and white. Like I wanted to go for that kind of balance of it's my own thing, but it is still kind of Celtic. Like green's my favorite color, but it needed to be green in some shape or form.
And of course works with the whole plant thing as well. It's all kind of falls into place.
That was just a coincidence. Like I wasn't even planning on having on using the vegan gimmick at that point. I was just like, green's my favourite colour, so we're going to go with that.
So who came up with the name Plant Based Powerhouse? It sounds like a Billy Kirkwood ad-lib, to be honest, but was that yourself?
It was actually... So I knew that I wanted the vegan gimmick, like, but I couldn't think of like a good epithet to use. I was like, oh, I don't want to like... St- steal someone else's, like adapt someone else's and just look like I'm ripping them off. So I was like, literally in my group chat to like all my girls, I was like, girls, I don't know what to do. Like, literally Jester was asking me like, what do you want your name to be when like, when you're getting called? And I was like, I don't know. Like I knew my ring name, but like I didn't know the nickname. So I was like, right, girls, group chat, help me. And I've got like one other pal who's vegan. She was like, what about plant-based powerhouse? And I was like, Danny, you are a genius. Thank you very much. So my best pal Danny came up with that, and I have to give her credit because it was her.
And then at the end, she could go the doing effort and go, I gave her that name there. It's just a plant-based powerhouse.
She can sue me for the naming rights.
When you're women's champion, that'll be it. That'll be her coming for you. So speaking of the future then, to round off the podcast, of course, you are wrestling. We've very much established that you are doing some wrestling. What's your dream? Who would be your dream opponents that you'd want to face?
Kevin Owens and Jericho were what got me hooked, but I think it was Sasha and Bayley proper what made me fall in love with like wrestling and be like, no, I actually really enjoy this. So if I got to wrestle Bayley one day, that would be like the ultimate dream, but I don't know if that's possible or if that'll happen. But I think, and the other one would be Viper. Like Viper is like the dream. Like I've got a photo of me in Viper after a fierce female show, literally the week before I started training, and I was like, yeah, this would be like the dream, like the start to finish, if you know what I mean. Like met her the week before started training to finally get into wrestler. It would be like a nice wee arc on my wrestling journey. I think,
is that the photo that you imagine using in the promo package like beforehand
of me? Like, look how I'm smiling next to you. Now I'm going to beat you up.
and as far as companies, it's of course, it's WWE, the be-all and end-all. Is there anywhere you want to go along the way?
I think WWE would be the be-all and end-all. Like, really, whether it's NXT UK or whether it's, like, WWE, like SmackDown, Raw, I don't care, either or, same prestige in my head. But before that, I would love to do like a tour of Japan. Like I've never been to Japan, I just want to go to Japan on a holiday really, but if I got to go to wrestle at the same time, that would be amazing. I'd love to, even if it was just one show, like one show in Japan, I think that would be amazing.
Absolutely right. So before we wrap up then, we'll do the social media bits in a second. If this is quite the bigger question that we're going to try and add for future podcasts, if you go back to your first day of training, speak to yourself, what would you tell yourself?
Start taking the gym more seriously, more quickly. I think it took me like a year to actually start like doing cardio in the gym, so do some cardio, Ellie, please. It'll make your life a lot easier in the long run.
Perfect. So where can people find you on social media?
I'm at Eyelid with two D's and an underscore on Twitter, and at ellyarmstrong.gpwa on Instagram. And I don't have a Facebook, I don't use it, so sorry.
That's rubbish anyway, you're not missing anything. Perfect, well thank you very much for joining me today. Absolute fantastic time. Hopefully by the time that either this goes out or this time next year, you would have actually wrestled in front of a crowd, which would be great. But fingers crossed. But yeah, I wish you all the best. Don't know why I go for a really heartfelt ending there.
But, how are you doing?